Nation family, welcome, welcome, welcome. It is Tuesday night and we are back for another Shift Live right here on YouTube and Facebook. Woo! All right, guys, so I'm your host for this evening. My name is Ayana Abaka. I am your host and also the co-director for Shift College and Young Adult Ministry. If this is your first time and you don't know what Shift is, Shift is the college and young adult ministry for World Changers Church International, Pastors Creflo and Taffy Dollar. So we come together every Tuesday night online. It used to be in person before the panoramic. And we just get together in the Word, talk about God, all that type of stuff, and just be a community, the squad. All right, guys, so I just have a few quick announcements for y'all, and I will get out your way so you can enjoy the rest of this service, okay? Okay. All right, so first up, remember, we are here every single Tuesday night at 8 p.m. So remember to tell a friend, to tell a friend, to tell a friend, call, text, whatever you need to do. Send a pigeon to some friends and invite them out. They want to get in the Word too? Come on, let's join this community of shifters, you know, building and growing and whatnot. Okay? So, also remember to like, comment, and subscribe, and then also follow us on Instagram at ShiftATL. Next up, our amazing pastors, every single day, they've been on live, and they do daily confessions. So we would love for you guys to join us every day, get the Word in, confess over your life, you know, get that Word. So you can do so by following Pastors Creflo and Taffy Dollar on their pages, Creflo Dollar Ministries, Creflo Dollar on Facebook, Creflo Dollar Ministries on YouTube. Subscribe, comment, do what you need to do, and join in every single day to get your spirit filled and edified, because listen, it's interesting out here, okay? All right, guys, so also on top of daily confessions, Shift on Tuesday nights, we have Wednesday night Bible study in the dome or in the chapel. We have Wednesday morning Bible study. We got Saturday service live from New York. And then we got Sunday service live in the dome. So you can check us out online or in person. If you're in Atlanta, come check us out on at 10 a.m. on Wednesday mornings, 7 p.m. on Wednesday nights. If you're in New York, online, 6 p.m. and then also 10 a.m. Sunday morning in the dome. So make sure and check us out, join in, tell a friend to tell a friend, y'all can carpool together, mask up, and let's get it. All right, guys, so that's all I have for now. Thank you so much for tuning in. We love y'all so very much. Air hugs, loves, and kisses. I'll see y'all soon.
Welcome, welcome. Anybody out there just gonna praise God with us? I said, anybody out there gonna praise God with us? I want you to just stand to your feet right where you are and give God some praise. Hallelujah. Just bless his holy name. Yes. Come on and just celebrate our God with us. We're just so excited to welcome you here today. Come on. Hey. Sing this with us. Woo. Come on, y'all. Hey. Here we go. Every time I turn around, blessings. Hey, every time I turn around, hey. blessings on blessings. Hey, every time I turn around, there's blessings. Hey, every time I turn around, hey. blessings on blessings. Hey, every time I turn around, come on, y'all say, around. I'll see blessings. Hey, every time I turn around, there will be blessings on blessings. Hey, every time I blessings. Hey, every time I turn around, there will be blessings on blessings. Favor of the Lord rest upon me. In my hands I have more than enough.
Hey, more than enough.
Surely goodness and mercy is following me, and my God will supply every one of my needs. Say that with us.
Favor of the Lord.
You say
in my hands, I've got more than enough.
You say,
surely goodness and mercy is following me, and my God will supply everyone.
Come on, do that again with us. Everybody say,
every
come messed up, put them in the air, say blessing.
Blessing.
Come on, say blessing.
Blessing.
Come on, say blessing.
Blessing.
Come on, put them in the air.
Come on,
say blessing. On blessing,
blessings on blessing.
I say blessing on blessing. Hey, I say blessing on blessing. I got blessing on blessing right now. Blessing on blessing for this Thanksgiving. Blessing on blessing. Blessing on blessing. Every time I turn around, every time I turn around, you keep on blessing me. Sometimes you gotta say those things that be not as though they were. I call a healing, I call a breakthrough, I call a miracle. Every time I turn around, you keep making a way. Yes, you do. Oh, we bless your name, Lord God.
What's going on, Shift family, Shift family, Shift squad? What's happening? How y'all doing? Welcome back to another amazing time at Shift. You could have been anywhere in the world, but you are here with us. You are in for a treat because tonight we are continuing our conversation. We're continuing our series on Are You the One? Now, this series is going to be really dope because it's going to kind of evolve into a couple other things. But the whole point of this series is we are we're entering our, and to be honest, I think this is the first one of the year. Our relationship talk for the year. Normally we do it around kind of Valentine's Day or season, you know, the love area when people start feeling different things. But we, again, I mentioned this last week, we're coming off of our most recent single seminar that we were a part of. And it was just on our heart to, you know, keep the conversation going, especially with you guys. So last week was awesome. And last week, if you missed it, go back and rewatch it. Not right now, but you can catch up after tonight, of course. But go back and rewatch it. The title of it was Are You One? Are You One? And really, it's about wholeness. Because at the end of the day, let's just be honest. This entire thing is about becoming whole or realizing your wholeness or pursuing wholeness. And we talked about that and kind of went into more detail of it, especially when it comes to being whole and becoming whole. Because how you want to get with somebody and you ain't whole? You putting the pressure on somebody else to do the work for you or to try to complete you. But nobody can complete you but God. God is the only one that can complete you. And it's his space that he has reserved that he can fill in your life, right? So go back and watch that. It's really good. But we're going to keep this thing moving, and I'm really excited for tonight. I don't even have like a whole heap of notes. I have a whole lot of trust. So tonight it's just going to be us and the Holy Spirit. So I'm going to go ahead and pray this thing in, and we're going to get right into it, all right? Father God, I just thank you and I praise you, Lord, for this time in you. I thank you, Lord, that you said in your word where two or more are gathered in your name, that you are there in the midst. So, Lord, we just welcome you. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Holy Spirit, let it be all of you and none of me tonight. I thank you, Lord, for this word, but even more, Father, I thank you for the word behind the word. I thank you, Lord, that the eyes of our understanding is enlightened. We get to hear you as clear as day. So right now, I decrease so that you can increase. And again, let it be all of you and none of me. And it's in your name, Jesus, we pray. All that agree said, hey, to the men. So go ahead and say what's up to the squad right now in the chat box. Say hello, say hi. Say howdy, wherever you're from, if you want to check in. I just want to, you know, say hi to y'all. Hi, y'all. So we're going to pick this thing up. I'm going to start with our, our foundation of this entire series. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6. I'm going to read Matthew chapter 6, verses 30 through 33. Matthew chapter 6. Verses 30 through 33. Matter of fact, I'm going to just do 31 through 33 for today. And I'm reading this one from the Passion Translation. So it reads, "So then, forsake your worries. Why would you say, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For that is what the unbelievers chase after. Doesn't your heavenly Father already know the things your bodies require? Verse 33, so above all, constantly seek God's kingdom and his righteousness, then all these less important things will be given to you abundantly. Refuse to worry about tomorrow, but deal with each challenge that comes your way one day at a time. Tomorrow will take care of itself." Now, the reason why this is our foundation scripture is because, to be honest, I mentioned this to you guys before, Ayana's mentioned it, and if you've been a part of the Shift family, you have heard this all the time. My life changed when I came into the scripture. My life completely changed. And to be honest, when it comes to the topic of wholeness and being whole and becoming whole, I believe that that's an area that a lot of us, we kind of neglect, or we rely on maybe what we remember. We rely on self-help. We rely on somebody else telling us certain things, where instead of actually going to God to receive the feeling that our bodies, or that we require, or that we even deserve, to be honest. So we're starting here because in this topic of wholeness, or even with, are you the one? I just gotta be honest. The conversations that we have with so many young adults, no matter where you fall in this young adult spectrum, but so many young adults, it's like this, there's so much focus on, I want a mate. I want a spouse. I want to get married. I want to have a family. And all of those things are good. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm for that. I'm not a person that's like, oh, don't worry about getting married. I'm not a bitter person when it comes to my marriage. You know, there's some people that they rather not even share the benefits or the highlights or the love or the life of marriage because they're so down about it and they look at everything negative. That's not us. I love being married. We love marriage. God loves marriage. But if you're not in a place of marriage, don't think that you're missing out as far as, oh, my life isn't complete until I get that. My life isn't complete until I get to this stage. God completes you. God completes you. Now, Baka, that's easy for you to say. You married. I understand. I understand. Believe me, I understand. But what I want you to know is, if I could do it all over again, and if I had to, If I was in this position where I was beginning to understand the value of becoming whole, the value in being whole, the value even in my singleness, would I rush through it and get married, or would I pursue wholeness? I'm telling you, without any type of nothing, I would pursue wholeness because it saves so much trouble. You can take time to become whole. So then once you get with the person that you end up coming across, now that person gets the benefit of meeting the whole you rather than a part of you. You get what I'm saying? There's so much value that sometimes, again, we neglect it because we just say, oh, you know, whatever. I just need, oh, you complete me. I mean, it sounds good. They're all in the movies. You know, you had me at hello. Like, that sounds good. All the sweet stuff. Like, I want to give myself to somebody. Okay, I get it. It sounds good until you're actually in it and you see the reality of what you're saying. To give somebody that power of, you complete me, What if that person leaves? Are you now incomplete because you don't have that person? Now you're trying to pursue or see, I have to get my completeness back, so I have to get that person. What if that person decides they want to be with somebody else? What if that person, God forbids, they pass away? Now are you just incomplete forever? Now is it that, oh, God can't do nothing with you because you're incomplete? No, wholeness is not tied to another person. Your wholeness is just tied to God. Your wholeness is tied to God. So let's actually get into this message. I'm just sitting there going, I'm really full. So tonight, this is part two. I said all that. But tonight, this is part two. And tonight's title, if you're taking notes, is Accepting the Whole You. Accepting the Whole You. So last week was, are you whole or are you one? And tonight is Accepting the Whole You. So let's go to Ephesians chapter 1 really quickly. No, pause that. Let's not go to Ephesians chapter 1. Let's go to Genesis chapter 1. Yeah, we're going to start there. Let's go to Genesis chapter 1. And I'm going to read it. I'm going to read it from the Message translation. Genesis chapter 1. I'm going to read verses 26 and 27. All right. I said chapter, not book. Genesis 1, verses 26 through 27. Here we go. All right. God spoke, "Let us make human beings in our image, make them reflecting our nature, so they can be responsible for the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, and yes, earth itself, and every animal that moves on the face of earth." God created human beings. He created them godlike, reflecting God's nature. He created them male and female. All right? Cool. We all know that. God created us. We came from God. We know that, right? I'm going to read it again, but this time I'm going to read it a little bit differently, so please make sure to follow along. All right. Verse 26. God spoke, "Let us make half a human being in some of our image and make them reflect a little bit of our nature so they can be responsible for the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, and yes, earth itself, and every animal that moves on the face of the earth." God created a little, like a partial piece of human beings. He created them a little godlike and not really reflecting God's nature. You saw that? You saw that? That's crazy, right? Like, God created us as partial human beings. He said, "Let us make sort of man," right? Like, you see that, right? I'm making sure that y'all reading along, because it's crazy that the Bible says this. It says, "Let us make partial human beings in our image and make them reflect some of our nature." You see that? Isn't that crazy that the word say that? That's crazy. Anyway, I'm glad that you're following along. God never created us as partial people. He created us as whole people. He created us as complete people. I mean, the fact that even in the beginning at the, I'm going to say it as the table of creation, but in the beginning, Genesis chapter 1, literally God did not create, he didn't even create man until everything else was completed. He created the earth, he created everything, and then he created man. But what if he said, "All right, let there be light. All right, now let's make man." Where the man going to go? he's just enlightened. He's enlightened. But God created everything, and then he completed everything, saw that it was good, and then he created man and made man in his image, reflecting his nature, making us godlike. But he didn't make partial man. He created whole human beings. So at the inception or at the creation of each of us, we were created as whole human beings. But somewhere along the road, we start to forget that we've been created whole. We start to only see pieces, or we start to see the pieces of us that's missing. Or a lot of times we see what we admire in other people, and we feel like because we don't have what that person has, then that means we're missing out. So now we've developed this sense of incompleteness. And we just live there. We live there thinking that we're missing out, thinking that God is holding back, thinking that we're incomplete or we're not complete until this happens. Like, we set our own milestones rather than understanding and knowing that when God created us, he created us whole. Everybody say that right now, or somebody typing in the chat, I am created whole. God created us whole. All right, now let's go to Ephesians chapter 1. I want you to hold your place there. We're going to go to Ephesians chapter 1. I'm going to read verses 5 through 6, but I want you to just hold your place there. I got to set this thing up. So, in us being created whole, I have to give a little backstory. So, of course, y'all know, hi guys, my name is Baca. Is that your real name? Yeah, it's technically my last name. So my name is Sylvester Abaca, right? That's actually my name. I go by the name of Baca. That's just what I've adopted over the years. But over the years, I had a lot of moments of seeking validation, or I felt that I was missing out on a lot of things. I felt that maybe I'm not complete in certain areas. I felt those same things that we're talking about right now, especially once I get a girl, everything will be settled. Once this happens, my life will be perfect. Once that happens, my life will be complete. So I'm speaking from a place of experience that I'm able to relate to you, especially if you're one of those people that's saying, man, but I just need somebody. I just want you to know, I get it. Baca gets it. Believe me, I get it. But I want to tell you this, this one of many stories, but I want to tell you this story really quickly about myself. So I am the middle child of three boys from my mom. Now I come from a very large family. There's a lot of us, right? Now, I don't even know if I ever said this story or what you all are about to hear. I don't know if I said it to you before, but we're just going to listen. But as the middle child, I always felt like I had to, it's like I developed this sense of I need to prove my worth. I need to prove who I am, or I need to prove what it is that makes me for people to actually accept me. I felt like if I wasn't doing something, I wouldn't be accepted. So I started to notice that I'm really good at a lot of things. I grew up playing basketball. Eventually, I like really fell in love with basketball. Everybody was always like, you need to play football. You're so strong. You're so blah, blah, blah. You fast. You need to play football. No, I'm not playing football. I play basketball. That's what I wanted to do. I really wanted to play basketball. I thought I was going to be a little bit taller, but that's another story. I'm still tall. But I love playing basketball. But unless I was doing something that people couldn't approve of, I didn't feel like I was accepted. Eventually, outside of basketball, I also did a lot of art. So I drew. I drew a lot of things. And as an artist, and I put it in quotes because I'm not like, I wasn't like one of them, but I could really draw. But I felt like unless I had something to show, I wouldn't be accepted. So I started to find myself looking for things that I was good at so that I can have almost like this full table, or this full thing of, look, everybody, look at everything I come with. Look at all the gifts that I have. You will accept me now, right? And I don't know where that really came from, because my parents love me. My brothers love me. My friends love me. But I still felt like in the back of my mind, maybe they only love me and accept me because of what I have, or because of what I can do. What I can do for other people makes them want to accept me. And that's not the case. But I felt like that really strong. Even when it came down to confidence, it's like I felt like unless I had a girlfriend, my friends would be like, man, you lame. You lame because you ain't got no girl. So I felt like I needed to have a girlfriend. So actually what I did growing up, I lied a lot. I said I was in relationships with girls, and I wasn't. Just being honest. I remember in kindergarten, I came home and said I got a girlfriend. Her name was Elizabeth. Her name was Elizabeth. And I pointed on the picture, the class photo. I was like, yeah, that was my girlfriend. That wasn't my girlfriend. I never talked to her in that kind of way. First of all, I was in kindergarten. I don't know what a girlfriend is. But I really just had a crush on her. Moving through school, I had so many different girls that I would have crushes on, and I would literally say, yeah, I talked to her. I talked to her because I felt like unless I had something to show, I wouldn't be accepted. All of my friends had this roster of girls. So I was like, well, I need to have a roster. But I was too afraid to talk to girls like that. So what did I do? I lied. I lied to be accepted. I lied to fit in because I wanted so bad to be a part of the group of, oh, well, we have all these girls. And I was like, I don't, but I'm going to sure make you believe I do. And what that did was it robbed me of the opportunity to actually see myself as the whole person God created because I spent most of my time trying to live up to what everybody else would accept. Now, was that a good thing? No, it ain't a good thing. What I should have been doing is taking a look at, okay, who did God make? Who's this person God made? Can I accept this person that God made? Am I willing to accept it at the expense of other people accepting it or not? And that came with maturity. But my point is, I was longing for so much for acceptance that I was trying to get it by any means necessary. And the whole time, God is like, if you would just open your eyes, you will see that you've already been accepted by me. But I couldn't see that. And it was all the way even to the point of my confidence. And my confidence as a dark-skinned male growing up in Atlanta, Georgia, south side of Atlanta to be exact, I was talked about a lot. Black this, black that, you so dark, you so such and such. And because of that, I started to feel like because of how much negativity or jokes that was connected to my skin color, I started to feel like, well, maybe I'm not really accepted. Maybe the girls don't really like me. And I remember asking girls in my class in the sixth grade, if I was light-skinned, would you like me? I was shocked at some of the responses because one girl blatantly said, actually, yeah, I think you'll be real cute light-skinned. I was like, man, how can I get light-skinned? Another girl said, no, I think you're real cute now. I was like, you think I'm cute? You think I'm cute? But my point is, I was so longing for that type of acceptance because I was basing it in how I viewed other people being accepted. And it wasn't until my older brother had to sit down with me and we're going to get into word, but I have to set it up this way. My older brother had a conversation with me. If you know my older brother, we look alike, a lot alike. Now, he's darker than me because I have red undertones. So I have like a warmness to my skin tone, and it's also shiny black. He's kind of like a matte black. He's like flat, so it's like he's just solid black. Me, you know, got some shimmer. But love you, bro. So what I noticed was I would notice how girls were always pretty much like him. They were like, oh, your brother's so fine. And they would tell me all the time, your brother's so fine. Your brother's so fine. Even my little brother, your brother's so fine. I'm like, man, I guess they real fine. I never heard anybody telling me that. All I heard was, oh, you're handsome. I was like, handsome sounds lame. I want to be fine. You call him fine. You call him fine. And I'm handsome or cute. I don't want to be cute. That's like a three-legged dog. A three-legged dog is cute. But that's what I was used to, right? And then one day, with tears in my eyes, I had a conversation with my older brother, and he told me, he said, you tripping. And he told me straight like this. He said, what do girls say about me? I said, they say you fine. He said, okay. Who do they say you look like?
They say we look like twins.
Okay. So if they say we look like twins and they say that I'm fine, doesn't that mean that you fine? I was like, but it kind of does. So I had to learn to actually see myself where I actually sat there in front of the mirror. I looked at myself and I said, okay, this is who God made. And there's a reason why I'm made the way that I am. There's a reason why my eyebrows are dark. There's a reason why my skin is dark. There's a reason why my face is shaped this way. There's a reason why my smile is like this. Maybe I should just accept it and embrace what he made rather than looking for somebody to accept when everybody had their own definitions of what was acceptable. So I was bouncing from everybody's opinion, driving myself crazy, looking for acceptance. Now, of course, in many ways, but specifically right now, I'm talking about in the area of confidence or in the area of the way that I was created. So with that, once I started to see, hold on, God made me this way and God doesn't make any mistakes. He did not create me as a partial man. He didn't say, all right, I made him. Let me, I'll get back to him later. I don't know what else I want to do with him. Or, hey, somebody else, angels, can you finish making him? No, God, with his detail, created me. And I said, wow, if you created me, that means that not only am I peculiar, not only am I fearfully and wonderfully made, that means you took intention in creating me. So maybe I need to accept me. And not accept me based on people accepting me, but accept me because I've been accepted by you. So now let's go back to as I mentioned, Galatians, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 5 through 6. I'm going to read it from the Passion Translation. So it reads, For it was always in his perfect plan to adopt us as his delightful children through our union with Jesus, the anointed one, so that his tremendous love that cascades over us will glorify his grace. For the same love he has for the beloved Jesus, he has for us. And this unfolding plan brings him great pleasure. Now, the reason why I wanted to read this scripture in particular is specifically for this piece right here. The same love that God has for the beloved Jesus, he has for us. The same love that God has for the beloved, for Jesus, the same way God loved Jesus, he loves us. And a lot of times we base our level of love, as I mentioned, based on what we can do, what we can provide. But it's not that. God doesn't love us based on what we can do. He created us. He knows what we can do. He loves us because he decided to. So a lot of us, especially as singles, we say, oh, God doesn't love me. I've heard this before. God doesn't love me because I don't have a spouse to share my love with. I've heard people say that before, where they feel like, well, God doesn't care, or where's God, or where's my husband, where's my wife? So they start to question, well, does God really love me? How do we arrive there? Is it because you feel like the only way that you'll have acceptance is when people accept what you do or what you have? Is your acceptance tied to your status? Or is your acceptance tied to the fact that God has accepted you? Because if it's tied to your status can change. If it's tied to God accepting you, that never changes because he decided to. Regardless of where you are, he's already made up his mind to accept you. He's made his mind up to love you. But if you base it on your status or what you have or what you can do, those things will change. And if it's based solely there, eventually you will drive yourself crazy because you're looking for the next high or the next thing. Well, maybe if I do this, then God will love me. If maybe if I do that, then God will accept me. Or let's just put it in our terms, because we in the back of our minds, we're like, I know God loves me. Maybe if I do this, people will accept me. Maybe if I have this, the people will love me. Whose acceptance do you want? Do you want people who can be fickle, or do you want God's acceptance and love who he never changes? I'd rather have consistent acceptance rather than this person liked me, this person can't stand me, this person loved me, this person loved to be around me, this person wished they had what I had, but this person just loves me. That's too much. That's too much. That's doing all this. All this to feel accepted, because you're bouncing from once one person accepts you, then you're like, all right, you accepted me, but that person doesn't accept me. And because that person doesn't accept me, I don't feel like I need to receive your acceptance, because I want everybody to accept me. And the whole time God is like, if you would just receive that I've already accepted you, none of that matters. None of that matters. Now, what does that have to do with being single and being whole? It has everything to do. You know why? Because once you know that you're accepted by God, your confidence is also attached to what you feel accepted by. Because now you're sitting there like, man, God accepts me. God loves me. Your confidence is based in that. Like, you're confident because you're like, look, look how God made me. Look how my smile has been created. Look at the way my skin tone is. Look at the way my hair lays. Look at my height. Look at my whatever you want to fill in the blank with, because you're seeing how wonderfully made you've been. And you're like, look at what God did. God did that for me. So then when it comes to other people that will change their mind, that will go back and forth, now you say, I don't care if you don't accept me, because I've already been accepted. I'm his beloved. The same way that he accepts Jesus is the same way that he accepts me. Amen? All right, let's keep it moving. Let's keep it moving. I have some more scriptures to go through. All right. Let's go to Psalms, because I'm going to share these scriptures and then we're going to be closing up. But let's go to Psalms chapter 139. Psalms 139. We're going to start at verse 1. This is necessary for tonight. I pray that y'all are getting something out of this, and I pray that this is helping, especially to have you like, you know what? Maybe I've been tripping. All right, Psalms 139, verse 1, and I'm going to read it from, I'm actually going to read this from the Passion Translation. So if you have that translation, you can follow along with me. Excuse me. Psalms 139, verse 1. Lord, you know everything there is to know about me. You perceive every moment of my heart and soul, and you understand my every thought before it even enters my mind. You are so intimately aware of me, Lord. You read my heart like an open book, and you know all the words I'm about to speak before I even start a sentence. You know every step I will take before my journey even begins. Let's pause right there real quick, because when it comes to accepting the whole you, the first step in accepting the whole you is also understanding that God is just aware of you. God is aware of you. A lot of times we don't feel accepted because we feel forgotten about. But God is so aware of you. And because God is so aware of you, it's like, man, like, why would I not accept what you're aware of? Like, you're so mindful and so aware of me, of the way that I talk, of where I'm about to step. Like, you're so mindful of that. That means you're thinking about me. That means you're, God is thinking about me. Is that worth accepting? Are you worth accepting? Can you accept you because God has already accepted you? All right, let's keep going now. Excuse me. Let's keep going on. Verse 5. You've gone into my future to prepare the way, and in kindness you follow behind me to spare me from the harm of my past. You have laid your hand on me. This is just too wonderful, deep, and incomprehensible. Your understanding of me brings me wonder and strength. Where could I go from your spirit? Where could I run and hide from your face? If I go up to heaven, you're there. If I go down to the realm of the dead, you're there too. If I fly with wings into the shining dawn, you're there. If I fly into the radiant sunset, you're there waiting. Wherever I go, your hand will guide me. Your strength will empower me. A way that you can know that you can accept the whole you is because, again, God is mindful of you. I'm going to repeat that. Like, God is mindful of you. He's aware of you. He's thinking about you on the regular. Let's keep on going. Verse 11. It is impossible to disappear from you or to ask the darkness to hide me, for your presence is everywhere, bringing light into my night. There is no such thing as darkness with you. The night to you is as bright as the day. There is no difference between the two. You form my innermost being, shaping my delicate inside and my intricate outside, and wove them all together in my mother's womb. I thank you, God, for making me so mysteriously complex. Everything you do is marvelously breathtaking. It simply amazes me to think about it. How thoroughly you know me, Lord. You even formed every bone in my body when you created me in the secret place. Carefully, skillfully, you shaped me from nothing to something. You saw who created me to. You saw who you created me to be before I came. Lord. You saw who you created me to be before I became me, before I ever seen the light of day, the number of days you planned for me were already recorded in your book. Every single moment you are thinking of me. How precious and wonderful to consider that you cherish me constantly in your every thought. Oh God, your desires toward me are more than the grains of sand on every shore. When I awake each morning, you're still with me. We can stop right there. Listen, the amount of detail that God has and takes with each and every one of us individually is mind-blowing. But the amount of detail we give to us feeling accepted, us desiring to be accepted, is actually mind-blowing. Because it's, I'm going to put it like this. I don't know if you guys are familiar with the show The Parkers with Monique and Professor Oglesby. We used to watch that years ago. But Monique had this crush on Professor Oglesby, right? And the crush she had on him, she was like, that's my boo, that's my bae. She was like, hey, boo! Like, that's the way she said it. But the thing is, Professor Oglesby would literally, like, turn his back like, ugh, get away from me. Why are you so obsessed? Why are you so obsessed with me? Ooh. Like, he's like, get away from me. I don't want to have anything to do with you. Like, why are you, leave me alone, pretty much, right? That was his attitude and his energy. But she didn't care because she made up her mind like, look, you're mine. You're mine and you're not going anywhere. And even when he would get other women, she'd be like, you in the wrong place because he's already with me. That's my boo. That's my bae, whatever. And he would get so frustrated. And the crazy thing is, it wasn't until she found somebody or somebody else showed her attention that's when Professor Oglesby got jealous and was like, wait a minute, you're supposed to be pursuing me at all times. What are you doing? Now, what does that have to do with accepting? It's almost like God is like Monique towards us. That he's so obsessed with us. He's literally thinking about us constantly. He's always in pursuit of us. He's always pursuing us. He's always after us. He's always there. He's literally, for lack of a better phrase, he's literally stalking us, right? He's sitting there watching us sleep. He's like, oh, look at them. Just so special. Just so beautiful. While when we wake up, he's planning out the day. He knows how great we would be before we even became to be who we are. He literally knows every detail about us. He knows the amount of hairs on our head. He knows the way that we talk. He knows the character that we have. He understands and knows the personality that we have because he gave it to us. He's literally there and thinks nothing but good thoughts towards us. He's always aware of us, the same way that Monique was about Professor. But for some reason, we treat God like we're the professor, like, oh, I know you want me. I know you there. Let me go on about my business, and I'm going to just leave you in my back pocket. And God is like, for what? I love you too much to live in your back pocket. Why not just turn around and say, all right, you got me. You got me. Because that's what God wants. He's like, listen, I'm not going to stop pursuing you. I'm not going to stop chasing you. I'm not going to stop thinking about you. I'm not going to stop being there for you. I will always be here. But can you accept my love for you? Can you accept that I've accepted you? Or do you require somebody else's acceptance over mine? That's a bad place to be. And that's not the place that God wants us. That's the place that God has for us. He's like, look, I accept you. I got so much more for you. So even when it comes to you being single and you're like, but I wish that I had somebody to accept me. God accepts you. I wish I had somebody there with me. God loves you. God, you're like, I hear you, but you don't understand. No, God loves you. The reason why I'm saying all this is because, again, once you know you're accepted, to be honest with you, your level of I don't care grows to a mind-blowing place where when somebody comes along, the moment that they show, like, you're not even about anything. You see so much value in who created you to, you see so much value in who God created you to be that anybody that's beneath that value, you're like, you know what? We can be cool, but honestly, I'm good, boo. And the crazy thing about that type of attitude and response is that that actually becomes attractive because people are like, wait a minute, how are you so confident? Because God loves me. I don't require your acceptance to build my confidence. My confidence comes from me knowing that God loves me, knowing that literally God is here, hands on my shoulders while we're talking. He's like, listen, you good, baby. You good. Go ahead. Just keep on going. So you approving of me or not does not do anything for me. Me knowing that God approves of me. God approves of me. That does everything for me. Then you can find yourself taking yourself out on dates. I ain't gonna do that. That lame. Get to know who you are. Get to know who God created you to be. Next week, I'm gonna share. I definitely got to share it now, and maybe Ayana and I, maybe we'll do it together. Maybe we'll see. But I'm definitely gonna share the importance, the importance of loving you, the importance of loving who God made. The reason why we're doing even focusing on being single and whole is because we place so much energy in somebody else completing us. We place so much energy and focus on what everybody else thinks. What does everybody else think about me? That doesn't matter. What we need to do is be free from what people think about us and receive the love that God has for us. Because if we can't receive the love that God has for us, what everybody else thinks about us will literally change us every single day. But the consistent love that God has for us, it grounds us. It becomes our foundation. We know we can't be touched. We know we don't need anyone's validation. We don't need anyone's approval because we've already been approved by God. But it starts there. I'm completely out of time. Completely out of time. And I have so much more to share, but we're going to have to pick up next week. Did y'all get anything out of this? I know that we're like talking because, you know, y'all in my living room and we're talking, but listen, the level of love that God has for you, when you're not tapping into it, when you're not actually taking time to understand it, to know it, to receive it, first off, you are doing yourself a complete disservice because you don't even allow God to shower you with his love. Instead, you feel like, man, nobody love me. I'm single still. Don't nobody love me. Listen, I told y'all before, I wanted a relationship so bad, so bad. Even to the point where I started crossing certain things off my list. Like, well, maybe I'm okay with this. Maybe I'm okay with that. And God said, man, chill out. This is what I want you to do. Seek me first. Why do I have to seek you? What does that have to do with a relationship? Seek me first, my righteousness, the way that I do it. Understand how I move. And everything else will be added unto you. Yeah, but you don't understand. That's what I want. I want this. And that's what I'm saying. I understand you guys. Because I'm sitting here talking to you guys. And I know that some of y'all are sitting there like, I hear you, Baka, but I just want to get in a relationship. I want to be loved by somebody. I want to love somebody. I want to go out on dates. I want to such and such. And you sitting there talking about seek first the kingdom of God. You're putting the cart before the horse. You're sitting there like, oh, I got to have this. I need to have this. And I'm sitting there saying, hey, yeah, wax on, wax off. No, I need to know how to fight. Wax on, wax off. Literally, this is Mr. Miyagi talking. It's wax on, wax off. Wax on, wax off. Wax on, wax off. Or for some of y'all, I know y'all don't know about the first Karate Kid, so I'll go to the Jackie Chan Jaden Smith. Yes, I'll go to that version. Pick up your jacket. Put your jacket on. Take your jacket off. Pick up your jacket. Put your jacket on. Take your jacket off. You're like, why do I have to keep doing that? Listen, there's so much in the foundation of understanding and accepting your wholeness that once you do, you now know how to approach, attack, how to confront, how to withstand, how to stand, period, when it comes to an actual relationship that you end up getting into. But if you don't start with wholeness, if you don't start with this place of, can I accept me? Can I love me? You leave yourself wide open for somebody else to say, the only way I'll accept you is if you have sex with me. But I'm a virgin. I'm not really trying to go there. I hear you. But that's what it is. Everybody else doing it. And because you don't know that God already loves you, because you don't know that God already accepts you, you take that person's requirements of acceptance and say, I'll lower myself so I can be accepted by them. But what would happen if you knew that you were accepted by God and somebody says, the only way I'll accept you is if you have sex with me? You'll say, well, I guess you just won't have to accept me then. What do you mean? You really gonna throw all this away? No. You really going to throw all this away because you're thinking that my life is only what's in between my legs, when in reality, my life is so much more. And you are missing out on a complete level of intimacy that you will never reach because you've now reduced me to what I have in between me. And the whole time, God is sitting there like, now, that's my baby. That's my baby. And you're sitting there like, yeah, you talking about the girls. No, I'm talking about you too, fellas. Because there are some ladies out here that are like, you don't want to have sex with me? What, you gay? What, you such and such? And you're sitting there like, no, I just value what it is that God created me to be. And I'm trying to share that with you, but you only see what's in between my legs. It goes on both sides. So again, what does this have to do with getting a relationship, getting finding your spouse? It has everything to do, because the moment you accept your wholeness, now you can setting your life up for when you meet that person, they get to meet the whole you. I ain't got no more time. We're going to pick up next week and we're going to go all the way in because it's time. I pray that you guys got some things out of this. I pray that tonight blessed you. And I thank you for joining us. So Father God, I just thank you and I praise you, Lord, for all that you are. And thank you, Lord, for this word tonight. I thank you, Lord, for you speaking behind, through, all up in, interrupting, doing what you do. And I thank you, Lord God, for the understanding that surpasses the the understanding that we have, and the joy and the peace that we have from even receiving what we got tonight that surpasses all understanding. I thank you, Lord, for your peace. The peace in knowing that we are accepted by you, that we are accepted in the beloved, that the same way that you see Jesus is the way that you see us. You love us. So we accept you. You're always aware of us. We accept that and we receive that. So Father, I thank you, Lord, for that your word will not return to you void, but it will accomplish that to what you have sent it to do. So Father, I thank you, Lord, that we are free from thinking that we need to be approved by somebody else. We receive your approval. We receive your acceptance. We don't need anyone else's acceptance to trump yours. We thank you, Father, that you are our standard. And we receive it right now. So in your name, Jesus, we pray. All that agree said, amen. All right, y'all. It's a lot more to this series. And we literally, with this just being part two, we literally just scratched the surface of it. And I'm not saying that as a, you know, some people, they try and be like, we're just scratching the surface. We really just scratching the surface. It's not to try to manipulate or anything. We are just scratching the surface. And there's so much power that each of us have, that each of you have, even as a single person, that the more we neglect tapping into what it actually means to be single, we miss out on walking in the way that God really even called us to walk a lot of times. Because again, we only relate, or we place our value in what everybody else accepts. And the whole time God is like, but you don't need that, because that's not true acceptance. That's conditional love. That's conditional acceptance. And if you chase that, you'll have conditional regret, conditional pain. You don't need that in your life. All right. So I have a real question for everybody that's listening right now. Do you really know Jesus, or do you just know about him? Have you said, oh, you know what, I'm good with my history lesson of Jesus, and I know that he was born in a manger. I know that his daddy name is Joseph, his mama named Mary, and she was a virgin, or so I heard. Is that the extent of that you know, or Or do you understand the love that he has for you? That literally he is, Jesus is literally God in physical man form. God breathed himself into a body and literally walked this earth for 33 years to show you the life that you're capable of having. But then even more than that, he said, you know what? I'm also going to die and take on every pain, every hurt, every disappointment. I'm going to take on every sickness. I'm going to take on everything that you would go through. Take it onto my body. Receive the pain, the torture, the everything from it, the hurt from it, just so you won't have to have that. Do you actually know that? Do you actually know what that means? Do you actually know just the example of life that he lived for each of us? So that when he died, he took each of our lives so that we can have his life. Do you know that? If you don't know that, allow me to introduce you to him, because he has so much more for you that you don't even realize. If you don't know Jesus, I'm so tired of the world trying to make it seem like being saved is the softest thing, and you got to be, if you get saved, you weak. First of all, if you don't get saved, you weak. It takes a real man and a real woman to say, Jesus, I accept you, come in my life. It takes a scared person to sit there and be like, I don't need Jesus. I do this on my own. You're scared and you're fearful. You're afraid. So if you don't know Jesus, allow me to introduce him to you. I want you to repeat this after me. Say, Lord God, right now I realize and admit that I am a sinner. And even more, I need you. I ask you right now to come into my heart, to cleanse me, to make me new. I change my mind, I change my direction, and I choose to pursue you. I ask you now to make me new, cleanse me, and I receive the life that you died to give me. Right now, by faith, I declare that I'm saved. Thank you for saving me. You're saved. You're saved. So give it up for yourselves, because this decision you made is the game-changing decision that you just made. Because your life is so much more than everybody else's approval. Now you can start to really understand that you've been approved and accepted by God. And you don't need everybody else's approval and acceptance. You don't need any of those other things, because as you pursue him, all these things will be added unto you. So if you just prayed that prayer for the first time, I want you to do this. I want you to text the word, I'm saved. That's one word. Text the word, I'm saved, to 51555. The information is on the screen right now. We have an ebook that we put together that we want to get into your hands, because we want you to further understand the decision you just made. You're now in a new family, a new dimension. And it's definitely necessary to understand this dimension that you're in. All right? So welcome to the family. Everybody right now in the chat, say welcome. Welcome. Man, listen. You're in. All right? So welcome. Secondly, before we get out of here, because I definitely want y'all to come back next week as we continue. But before we get out of here, also, if you would like to sow into our ministry, you can do so right now. You can do it really simply. You can pull out your phone. You can text the word world changers. That's one word. Leave a space and then put your amount. So let's say you wanted to sow or give $20. World changer space 20. World changer space 10. World changer space 50. Whatever it is that God placed on your heart to give. And you can text that right now to 74483. The information is also on the screen right now. We made it simple. It's safe. It's secure. But man, it's appreciated. All right, it's definitely appreciated, because God is really doing some things, and we thank you for your continued support over the years. Man, this series isn't a small one, and this isn't our regular relationship thing. When we're definitely going to get into multiple things, but this is necessary. This is necessary. So. I'm so out of time, but I want you guys to have an amazing week. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Thank you for being a part tonight. Thank you for engaging in the chat. And I want you to stay tuned for these closing announcements. And be sure to be right back here next Tuesday as we continue. Are you one? I'll see y'all next week. All right. Good night, y'all.
All right, guys. So that was an amazing, amazing word tonight. Thank you so much for tuning in. Remember, if you would like to give an offering, you can just follow the instructions on the screen. And also, check us out next Tuesday. So we're here every single Tuesday evening at 8 p.m. So tell a friend to tell a friend, like I always say, and tell a friend, text them, call them, send a pigeon, whatever you need to do to invite them out to check out Shift with you guys, to build a little community together as we build this online community together. I love you guys so much, and we will see y'all next Tuesday.